Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself is easier said than done. And what these surahs do, from Al-Ahzab to Zumar, it just looks at the concept of submission from every possible angle. Just looks at all the different angles that you can, that you are required to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through, and it studies it. And I believe, and that's why I think it's an important part or chunk of the Quran to learn, because submission at the end is what the what Islam actually means. The word that makes us unique, or the word that stands out in terms of who we are as a faith, is the concept of submission. It's not, Islam is not peace. I know we like to play that card because we're scared, but it's not peace, it's submission. It's the fact that you don't argue with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You'll argue with everyone else, but not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone else is subject to a comeback, is subject to criticism, to critiquing what they said. You think about it, you go through it, then you choose if you like it or not, and you may be a part of it, you may not, and that's how you're supposed to live your life. Except when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says something, that's when you give up. You give up your will to His will. And you're going to see how this is not easily done. So Surat Al-Ahzab, the first surah in this cluster, talked about the concept of submission, and it looked at it when it was specifically hard to submit, when it is specifically and especially difficult to do so. And it gave it when it's physically hard to do so, like the battle of Ahzab, or it's financially hard to do so, like the example of the Prophet's wives, or it's socially hard to do so, when the Prophet had to tell people that he's going to marry Zainab, the ex-wife of Zayd, which was a social nightmare for him, and proved to be so when he actually did it. They used that against him all for the rest of his life, or when it's psychologically difficult to do so, and etc. And that's what that's why it's the longest of all the surahs, half a juzu, and it goes through all those different, because that's the one, because it's easy just to say it, but then you're put in a position where you need to submit to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's hard and it's uncomfortable and you don't want to do it, and deep inside you wish you didn't have to, but will you still or will you not, or you'll find a way out. That's where, you know, your Islam actually shows. Now Surat Saba looks at the same concept, it just looks at it from a different angle altogether. It looks at it from a social angle, from a community-based angle. That communities submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well, and their success will be based on the fact whether they submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not. Is it exclusively based on that? No, it's not exclusively based on that. It's just the Quranic way of looking at things. That in order for a society that has all the components that will allow it to thrive, so it has equity and it has justice and it has freedom of speech and freedom of thought, and it has all these, and it has science and it has knowledge and it has all the components and constituents that will allow it to thrive, what the Quran is saying is that it needs submission. It needs faith. Without religion, it's not going to go far. It'll make it, but it won't go far. It will fall. You need faith. Faith is a part of thriving. I mean, faith is another component that allows societies or communities to thrive. And that is a way of looking at societies or communities or civilizations that goes, I'm not going to say goes against, but it just doesn't, it's not how sociologists look at it today. If you're studying sociology or psychology, that's not really what they look at. It's not something that they're interested in. There are different, they look at the common values that a society will share. And that's all nice, because at the end of the day, as humans, we share common values. We believe in freedom, we believe in justice, all that. No one denies. And if you take that away, your society is not going to thrive regardless of how much faith it has. It doesn't matter. These are the common sense necessities of any society to thrive. Is the Quran comes and says it needs to have faith, and it needs to do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the example we were given within Surah Saba so far is the example of Dawood alayhi salam and Sulaiman alayhi salam. So it gave us an example of a civilization that did thrive, and it thrived based on faith, and it had continuity. That's why Dawood and Sulaiman were both talked about here, because it continued to go through, and they had knowledge, and they had industry, and they had and they produced things. They weren't just buying. They were just consuming. But with all that, كُلُوا مِن رِزْقِ رَبِّكُمْ وَاشْكُرُوا لَهُ. Or sorry, وَاعْمَلُوا آلَ دَاوُدَ شُكْرًا. اعْمَلُوا آلَ دَاوُدَ شُكْرًا. وَقَلِيلٌ مِن عِبَادِيَ شَكُرُوا. Oh, people, followers of Dawood, act with the intention of showing gratitude to Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, and that is why they thrived. And the example of the jinn in this story as something that Dawood and Sulaiman had under their control. The concept of superstition, all the ghaib that we don't know how to deal with in our societies today, and it runs our lives. It rules the way that we think and the way that we're responsive to it and reacting to it. On the other hand, Dawood and Sulaiman, this is something that they used that was under their control. And that shows you how societies, thriving societies, societies don't submit to superstition. They don't submit to issues of ghaib that they can't prove, that they can't actually treat or deal with. They don't use issues of ghaib to hold them back from achieving. They don't use issues of ghaib to cause them not to be able to move forward. They don't use jinn and sihr and na'in and all the and hasad and these stuff to cause them to be stuck in a place where they don't know how to assign blame, and they don't know how to improve their mistakes, and they don't know how to move forward because there's a whole chunk of their lives that is unexplained and has no way, you have no way to actually deal with, that is going to stay there just affecting you negatively for the rest of your life. When you look at Dawud and Sulaiman's example here, it was they worked for them. The jinn were under the mercy of Dawud and Sulaiman. I think it's very symbolic, and it has a very important indication in the way that we're going to look at it. Now, the second example is going to be the opposite. It's going to be a group called Saba. Now, they exist. Now, Dawud and Sulaiman, of course, they were in Jerusalem during their story. And at the same time, and this is why these two stories come together a lot in the Quran, especially here in this example of societies that need to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dawud and Sulaiman, they submitted to Allah. Even though they were extremely, extremely powerful, even though they controlled more than any other society in history ever did, but they did it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَعْمَلُوا صَالِحًا اعْمَلُوا أَلَى دَوْدَ شُكْرًا. This is what they did. They used it for good. And they used it for good for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and showing gratitude and showing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they're thankful for what He has offered them, what He has allowed them to achieve. Same time, on the other side of the map, well, maybe not the whole map, but the Middle Eastern Peninsula map, down to the south, in a place between Sana'a and Hadramaut in Yemen. So you can go to the map today and look at Hadramaut and Sana'a. Somewhere between, there's an area called Maghrib. I believe it's still called Maghrib today. The whole area, there's not a city. But the whole area called Maghrib. And in that area, there was a civilization that also stood. That was called the civilization of Saba. Or what is known Sheba, if you can go, and you will find it on Wikipedia if you want to learn a bit more about it. The details, the historical details aren't very important to me in terms of the context of the surah and the story. What's more important is the comparison. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a comparison between how Dawud and Sulaiman functioned and how Saba is going to function. What is in common between them both is that they both have the components, they both had the components of a thriving society. They both had equity, they both had justice, they both had social security, they both had a thriving industry, whether agriculture or industrial. They were powerful. So Saba, just like Dawud and Sulaiman, both had power. Saba was not weak. And this is what's going to be explained immediately at the beginning of the surah, that they actually were given a lot. They had a lot of provision. They were rich. They were a rich society. But they weren't going to go very far. And the reason is going to be something that is missing. And I understood there's going to be something that's missing for them that wasn't missing for Dawud and Sulaiman alayhi salam. And this is the perfect example for us to learn from as Muslim societies and communities all around the globe. Our countries do not lack provision. They don't lack resources. We probably have the most resources of everything on the planet. We are very rich countries when you look into what's inside the ground, and very rich in terms of the populations that we have and the youthfulness that we have within our populations. However, we don't make it, and the reason that we don't make it is because there are certain things that are missing. The things that are missing, the Quran here is not talking about. Because the Quran here looks at them as being things that are common sense, that are given. Of course, a society that is corrupted, of course, a society that is filled with oppression and filled with nepotism and filled with transgression against its own people is not going to thrive. It doesn't matter how much iman it has in it. It really doesn't matter. It's not going to make a difference because you are missing the basic needs, the basic necessities of a society to thrive. It's not going to work. And that just, you know, that's pretty much a child that is not treated properly at home, that doesn't get a good meal, that doesn't get a good night's sleep, you can't expect him to perform at school. You cannot expect him to perform at school. No matter how much you try and study different methods of teaching this child, he will not learn or she will not learn because there are certain necessities that don't exist. If he's not eating properly, sleeping properly, is not being cared for at home properly, he's not going to learn. So if you focus your time trying to fix the methods of teaching for this child, you're going to waste a whole lot of time, a whole lot of money, and a whole lot of resources, and really not get very far because the actual problem is in a different place that you refuse to look at. And this is just an example that I wanted to kind of bring up in terms of how we look at things. So when the Quran talks about faith here and iman, and how you need to use that to help a society thrive, What Surat Saba message is that you will build your civilization on iman. Meaning, one of the pillars of your civilization and society. What's going to allow you to thrive and to rise is going to be the fuel of iman. Use it. Use it for tanmiyah. Use it to help you thrive and stand up. But it's not looking into the other components, because those are common sense components. They have to be there. The Quran doesn't have to talk about it, but it does talk about it. Just to make this even more clear, the Quran does talk about it. Did it when it talked about Dawud alayhi salam, just to kind of refresh your memory? Did it not talk about the fact ya jibalu awwibi ma'ahu wat-tayr? So there was a general. Everything was contributing with Jawud alayhi salam, even the mountains, even the other creatures. Did he not, alayhi salatu wasalam, alanna lahul hadid? He was given the ability to manipulate iron and to make blade mills. He had he was able to improve warfare for his country in a way that no other army or no other country had at the time. So there was science and there was knowledge and there was technology within the abilities of that time, because that's a normal part. Of course that's going to be there. But what you need with all that, you're going to need iman. This is the message that Surah Saba is trying to give us all. Now why did I say all this? Just to make a point very clear, so that when we're reading this, no one gets confused. I think this is why Surah Saba is not recited as much. The societies that we have today lack these things. The Muslim societies that we have today lack these basic stuff. So when we come and read Surah Saba, and we're trying to build our societies on iman, it's not going to work, because there's stuff that are missing that we haven't fixed yet. Because there's no equity, and there's no equality, there's no freedom, it's full of corruption, and oppression is everywhere. So for me to talk to you about iman, let's build on iman, kind of sounds a bit obnoxious, and maybe a bit passive as well, and maybe ignorant. Because we don't have the basic things to actually build upon. So let's forget about that, because we're not living in the Middle East where these countries, we're actually living here where we have a bit more, where we have freedom, we have equity, we have a lot of social security, a lot of things that we need. Now what is it that will cause us not to move forward? Again, another reason, is that our societies and communities that we have here, our Muslim societies and communities, they lack centralization, they're not centralized. There's no centralization in our societies. We don't centralize on any level, not politically, not religiously, not socially, not financially. And when you lack centralization in society, it is impossible for you to call what you have a society to begin with. So you can't really thrive, because you're not really a society yet. And until that exists, the beautiful messages and benefits of reading Surah Saba is going to be missed. Is that okay? Yeah, of course. In the Quran, there's a lot of stuff that you may never ever actually practice yourself, which is fine. You may never actually carry a sword, or you're actually never going to carry a sword. You're never going to carry a weapon and fight for the sake of Allah. You may never do that. You may never be required to do that. And that's okay. It doesn't mean that this part of the Quran does not apply to you. It applies to you. You just may not be given the opportunity to actually do it. You may not be put in the circumstances where this is something that you're required to do. For example, if someone who lives his life poor, or someone who never leaves money around, is always giving the sadaqah, never ends up paying zakah, for example. Does that make this person less of a Muslim? That makes this person someone who is not following the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, it's just sometimes you won't follow everything said, just because circumstances and opportunities may not present themselves. So for us, when we read Surah Saba, there's a lot of benefit in it, but there are a few elements that are missing in order for us to take what's in it. And I just want to make that point clear. Because if you're wondering why is it that we don't seem to be able to make any steps forward, even though our numbers are huge, and we're very youthful, and there's actually a lot of money in our society if you were to look at it objectively. And we are maybe the only society that comes together once a week, every single week, all year round, no days off, no weeks off. Every week there's a Jum'ah, and every Jum'ah the masajid are full, and messages are being given forward, and we still can't seem to do anything. We still can't seem to make any progress, actual progress, where we can see differences in generations. We can see changing of mentalities, changing of behaviors. We can actually see people coming together, more networking, and more achievements on personal levels, and on small group levels, and on societal levels. The reason is because we lack centralization. We lack a part of societies that the Quran looks at as common sense. It's just a maxim. It's an axiomatic issue. Of course that you're going to need this. What are you talking about? When the Quran tells you to take care of your kids, it doesn't go through the process of explaining to you how you need to achieve bulugh and get married and have, because that's, of course you're going to do that. How are you going to have a kid? Like, how can I have a kid to begin with if you don't do all these things? That's common sense. I remember one of our teachers One of my teachers used to say that when we make dua in Ramadan, Allahumma ansur al-Islam wal-Muslimin, he said to him this is similar to a single man saying, Allahumma grant me three children, their name, go get married, Habibi Blawal. How about you get married first and then we talk about your future kids? How about you do that first? They stand, you're single, Ya Rabbi, I want kids and I want them to be, oh, are you married? No, what are you, why? What's, that's very awkward, that's kind of weird. Maybe take the step that you can take first. Maybe ask for that step first. Maybe ask Ya Rabb Subhanahu wa Ta'ala to grant you a pious wife. Maybe that's the first thing to ask for. Wallahu alam, I think that's where we kind of fall in understanding that. Doesn't mean that I don't think Surat AlSaba is important. I think it's very important. I think we should definitely learn it and take all the messages within it. But I do want you to know that there is a step, we're one step behind. We're one step behind from actually being able to take what's in it and benefit from it. And if you look at the historical timing of Surat AlSaba, when it was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, the revelation of it, it was revealed to him during the end of the Mecca period, just before he went to Medina ﷺ. So just before he went to Yathrib, where he was going to build a society, where it's going to be different now. In Mecca, they were sporadically living in the city, trying not to die of transgression and oppression. They didn't really have they had a few things centralized, but generally speaking, they weren't a full society at the time. This surah came just towards the end of that, as wallahu alam, a lesson, something for the Prophet ﷺ to take before he went to Medina, because he was going to need the information here. He's going to need the ideas that existed here to recite it upon the Sahaba, so they would know what to expect and what to look for. And wallahu alam, that would, you know, surahs like this made the difference in terms of how the Sahaba functioned within Medina, because when you look at it, they lived two different lives. They almost lived almost opposite streams of lifestyles. Living in Mecca and Medina it was very difficult. It's much more difficult than we tend to understand. When we look at Sirah, we don't look at that part. It's very hard to move physically, geographically, from one place to the other, and then live in a completely with a completely different message or a completely different outlook at things. Meaning in Mecca, there were certain goals that they had become accustomed to. They were used to this routine. They knew what they needed to do, they knew how to do it, and they were doing it. Meaning what you needed to do in Mecca is you needed to have good relationship with the people around you, you needed to hold back from transgression, never fought back, you kept things secret, you learned Islam from the Prophet ﷺ. That's what you did. For 13 years, they learned how to do it, they did it well. And then in Medina, everything is different. In Medina, everything was going to change. Everything, every part of who they were was going to completely change. Now your message needs to be unleashed, and you need to talk about it, and you need to defend it, and you have a country, and you need to be able to make a living, defend your country, learn Islam, and spread it to others. It's a whole different concept altogether. And now you're no longer a minority being oppressed where people feel sad for you. Now you're established country that needs to prove itself worthy of the message that it carries, which is a different thing. Playing the victim is easy. Actually, some people, you know, are very good at it, and they live all their lives playing the victim. Psychologically, psychologists will look into people like that, and they'll help them out, and they get a lot of therapy. Because when you chronically play the victim, you don't know how to do anything else. If you are not, if you don't have the lower hand in every situation where you are just not given the right chance, or you're not being treated well, or you didn't, you don't know how to act when you're given everything you want. They panic, they don't know. So they mess it up and they find someone to blame so they can be the victim again. And I believe our societies have become chronically playing that victim mentality. Like we like being the victims. We like seeing things screwed up and say there's no way to fix it, and it's someone's fault. Depending on where you live, you'll blame something different. I mean, depending on where you live, it depends on what part of the world you are. There's always a group to blame. It's always someone who's causing all the problems. And where I come from, it's Israel. They are the reason for everything wrong. Everything. Wallahi, if the water gets cut off one day, it's them. Everything is them. If it's not them, then it's the government. And if it's not them, there's always someone to blame. And that puts us in the victim seat. We're always masakeen. It's not our fault. Other people are doing and that is a very dangerous way to live. It's very, very dangerous. And it's not Islamic at all. And I think that's one of the beautiful points of why the Prophet ﷺ had to have his hijrah. They had to get out of the victim mentality. They couldn't continue to be the victims. In Mecca, they were victims. But they were victims who were sabirin. They were showing perseverance and they stood their ground, which is great. But they were given a chance to not be the victim anymore. And they didn't. And they got out of that. They didn't play that role anymore. They weren't the victims. And they went and they spread things. And Islam, in 30 years, was in three continents. Because they weren't, they didn't want to be the victim. It was something they were stuck to. A lot of us may enjoy playing that role. Just watch out for yourself. You may find like a trait in your personality that enjoys being mazloom, being oppressed. No, you're not supposed to be oppressed. You're not supposed to be hoping for it or trying to be it. No, you try to be, get your rights, take your rights. Don't be mazloom. Definitely don't be zalim, don't be an oppressor, obviously. I mean, that kind of goes without me explaining. But don't be an oppressed person. Don't accept oppression. You see that a lot in relationships, by the way, in family relationships. You see, there's always that one person who is just, everyone walks all over all the time. And they accept it because, no, you're not supposed to accept it. You're not supposed to be someone who's oppressed within a family relationship. You're supposed to, everyone's supposed to treat everyone properly with respect and with integrity. And that's an important part of living a healthy life and having healthy relationships. And a lot of us just don't know how to do it. And I thought that was worthy of bringing up. So we, I think here, our problem as Muslim societies here, is that we still are living that kind of victimized mentality. We're still enjoying being the victim. That's why nothing works here. Because I don't know. I don't know what it is that causes us not to thrive here. I really don't know. And I came in 2013. I haven't been here very long. And I was used in Syria to having a hanger. Like, we had a hanger. Every time I failed in something, I took it off. And it's because of this. It was because of, government. It was because of someone. It wasn't my fault why this didn't work out. And we were used to it. And I didn't really pay attention when I was living there to that. To be honest, I didn't pay attention. When I came here, I didn't have anything to blame anymore. Meaning when I saw how horribly things sucked when I came here, how bad it was, just how bad it was, how everything just was nothing. And I wondered, who's to blame for all this? Israel? No, they're not here. Governments, they don't care. Who's to blame? I found no one to blame but myself. It was just us. We're to blame. We're the ones who don't want to do it. We're the ones who don't want to come together and sit together and fix up and work out our problems and have common goals. We just don't want to do it. So it's really no one to blame. But when you look at it, it's 30 or 40 years into this, and we're still where we were. I mean, not much has changed. You start to wonder, maybe there's a sociological problem. Of a mentality that hasn't changed, that needs to change. This surah, and that's why I think this surah is so important, because this was revealed to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Mecca. He still sleeps, scared that they're going to come and assassinate him in his home. People are still being tortured. Bilal and Ammar and Talha and Zubair, they're still being tortured. Everyone's living on their own. And this surah comes and talks about Dawood and Sulaiman, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him to manipulate iron and liquefy copper and build his own. Understand the idea? Jinn were under him, not just what was seen. The unseen was going to be under them, giving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this optimistic feel that, look, this is what you're supposed to be trying to do here. You're supposed to be trying to be like Dawood and Sulaiman, but not like Saba. They had all the components of success as well, but they just lacked one. They lacked one, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took it away from them. And we're going to read that story today, and we're going to see what it talks about. We begin from ayah number 15 in Surah Saba. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد كان لسبأ في مسكنهم آية جنتان عن يمين وشمال كلوا من رزق ربكم واشكروا له بلدة طيبة ورب غفور So indeed, for Saba, within the place that they lived in, within their story, في مسكنهم, where they were, ayah, there is an ayah. There is a sign and there's a lesson to be learned. Like I said, the word ayah in the Quran, 99% of the time, is not talking about an ayah in the Mus'haf. It's talking about a sign, something that you can learn from, something that will direct your thought process into a certain direction to allow you to contemplate upon something. So indeed, within the place that Saba lived, there is an ayah. So what was the story? Jannatani an yamini wa shima. There were two large orchards on the right side of them and on the left side of them. So basically, if you look at Maghrib and where they lived, they were surrounded by a green belt that goes from the right to the left. And Yemen is actually a very resourceful country. I know what we see today within the sorrowful and sad stories that we see there in terms of the people and their suffering and the hunger and the war that is going on. But actually Yemen is a very resourceful country, at least before maybe 100 years, just going back 100 years. It was very green and had a lot of resources in it. And Jannatani an yamini wa shimal, I mean, it was just green, green orchards on the right side of them and on the left side of them. So they weren't limited to one source, they had two sources. What were they told to do? Kulu min rizqi rabbikum. By their prophets and by the messengers who spoke to them, just like any other group on earth, they were spoke to and told to do the same thing. Eat from the provision of your Lord, washkuru lahu, and show him gratitude. Is that not the exact same command that Dawood and Sulaiman were given? Exact same words. I'malu saliha, I'malu ala Dawood ashukra. The same words, so nothing has changed. There's no different command to them in comparison to Dawood and Sulaiman's group. No, same command, same basic concept. You have, they have. They have a different type of industry. If you look at Dawood and Sulaiman, it was more, it was metal. It was iron and copper. For them, it's going to be agriculture. They have a lot of fruit and a lot of food. If you read the writings of Ibn Battuta, he said you would walk within Maghrib, within the area, you would walk and you would just have an open bag or something, and by the time you finished walking just through the orchards, your bag would be filled with fruits, because it's just all continuously throughout the summer just falling from the trees. There's so much of it, and so you just open, just walk, and they'll just keep on falling, and you'll have like a whole bag full of stuff. It's a very prosperous place. It was very rich with resources and with agriculture. So kulu min rizqi rabbikum washkuru lahu, and show him shukr. Now I didn't talk about this last time. I left it specifically for now, just so that we can go in a bit of detail into it. So the form of submission of societies, what is it? This is the beauty of learning from Ahzab to Zumar. We're going to see that submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes in different forms. For during the day of Ahzab, what was the form of submission that they had to show? It was bravery. You're not going to run. You're going to stand your ground. You're not going to run. You're scared as heck. You've never been more scared in your whole life. You have a million reasons to want to go home. You're going to stand your ground, and that is your submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The form of submission of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We're going to stay without the economic prosper or the economic promise of a better future from a financial perspective. That was their form of submission. The form of the submission of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when in the garden of the story of Zainab, is that he was going to marry her, even though he didn't want to. He didn't want to have anything to do with this story. This story was going to smear everything. The form of submission was marriage. Meaning the form of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes in different forms. Does that make sense? The concept is one, but then how it actually manifests itself is going to be different. Every time it's going to be a different thing. So for societies, for communities, for civilizations, what is the form of submission? It is shukr. That understood? It's shukr. It's twice. If you look at the example of Dawood and Sulaiman, يَعْمَلُ أَلَى دَاوُودَ شُكْرًا. And then when it moved on to the example of Saba, كُلُوا مِن رِزْقِ رَبِّكُمْ وَشْكُرُوا لَهُ, and show gratitude to him. Meaning understanding shukr is going to be, and being able to practice shukr socially, is the form of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we show from a societal perspective. So how is that going to be done? How is that going to be achieved from a societal perspective? This is not the form of submission that we do as individuals. No, we're talking about communities here. Communities have to be thankful. So how do we be grateful or thankful as communities? When you think about it, you come up with a few concepts. It's not too hard to see. So number one, you give back. So the first thing is that you give back. Meaning if you are blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with something, you take it, you use it for yourself, obviously, but then whatever you have extra, you make sure that you give back to those who need it, number one. Number two, you're not wasteful of what you have. Number two, what you have, you do not waste it. It's not, you don't do tabdhir. You're not extravagant in how you deal with it. Isn't, when you think about these things, it's kind of, again, are these common sense topics or not? They're pretty common sense, but what changes is why you're doing it. What changes is why. The reason that communities do it is going to be out of submission. is going to be out of this. Why? This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. Why we help other societies, why we stand by other communities, why we give back, and why we're not wasteful, is because that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to do. Because sometimes for a lot of societies and other groups, the reasoning may not be clear. Sometimes the reasoning will be hard.
So kind of intention?
Exactly, the intention will be, so intention in this context also means why we're going to do it. So how do you explain to groups of people why it is we're going to help this group, or why it is we're going to be we're not going to be wasteful of this specific resource? Why? Well, they're going to come back with a lot. There's going to be a lot of discussion regarding this, but the actual reason for us is because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to do. Which is the third example of gratitude is that it's not used for harm. And we talked about this in Surah Al-Kahf when we talked about Dhul-Qarnayn, is that the power that you're given, or the strength or the provision, will not be used to harm. You're not going to use it to harm other people, to destroy other societies, to harm other communities, to use it as leverage to get what you want, to exploit people's weaknesses or exploit people's poverty. You're not going to use it for harm. And again, from a societal perspective, this may be hard to convince people of. Well, you know, we have so much, why are we giving it away for free? Why are we not charging people for this? Why are we not holding people to... Because that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. And I'm just giving simple examples. I'm not saying that this is how... I'm just giving simple examples. Is that societies, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us, and we have a lot, we give back, we're not wasteful, we don't do harm. And the reason is because that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to do. There's no other reason for it. And that's a key difference. I'm telling you, that is a key difference. We get caught up with a lot of personal issues of qiyam and akhlaq, of values and ethics. We don't look at how countries function. Countries have no ethics at all. If you are to study political sciences, you will find out very quickly that there are no ethics when countries deal with one another. Everything comes with a price. And the price tag on everything is astronomical. There is no country that does khayr to another country for free. It doesn't exist. You'll see it on personal levels. Some person will do it to someone else, but you will not see it on a continental or a country based level. You will not see it. It doesn't happen. The way the system of the world works is actually so ethicless that it's scary. I mean, when you start looking into it, it's very hard to understand. Also, how do you explain the fact that every country you've ever heard about is in debt? How are all countries in debt? And who are these countries in debt to? Who has all the money? If every country is in debt, all right, who has the money? I don't know who we're in debt to. Just explain to me who has all the money. I don't want to hustle the guy. I just want to know who has the money, because everyone seems to be in debt. Every country, every bank, everyone's in debt. Okay, then who owns it all? It's just an ethicless process of exploitation that happens all throughout history. Or else, how do you understand all the wars? And once you understand, when you start understanding these things, when you look into it deeper, it makes sense to you, and you're disgusted by it, to be honest. It's very... So that's why here in the Quran, the concept that is going to be talked about from a societal perspective, from a civilization, from a country aspect, is going to be shukr. It's going to be, you have to be very thankful and very grateful for what you have, by giving back, by not being wasteful, by not using for harm, etc., etc., etc. There's a lot of different ways to show gratitude. And you're going to do it because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you to. It's a sign of your submission. You understand why Saba is here in this big cluster of surahs? It's a sign of your submission. If your society actually submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that is what it's going to do. And that's how it's going to function. And I believe that to be... Of course, do we have examples of that? Of course, we look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's example. You look at how the Sahaba functioned with one another as a society. How the Ansar opened their homes for the Muhajireen. Had this concept not been clear, that example would have been impossible to even... To even suggest. How do you suggest that? How do you suggest that everyone opens their home for another family to come and live in indefinitely? How do you suggest that? How does that even work? Who is going to say yes to this? Of course not. You say the country, I don't know, tax us and build homes for them. I'm not bringing them to my own home. That's impossible. Go build houses or something. You're the government, figure it out. No, they're going to come and live in your houses, and then you say yes. How does that work? I don't understand how that works. I still can't understand it. I am baffled and will continue to be baffled all of my life of how mu'akha during the Prophet ﷺ's life actually worked. I do not understand how it worked. Because I cannot imagine, because I tried it. I'll tell you what, because I tried it. Because during the 2012, a friend of mine, a really, really close buddy, someone I loved, I still love till this day, and he needed to come to my home and you need to stay with me for a week. And that was the most difficult week of my entire existence. That was the hardest week of my life. They lived inside the house. It was so hard. I did not know how to deal with it. And I learned how little I understood the concept of muakhara, how little I actually understood it. I didn't understand it. Because when you try it, like, oh, this is not, I can't do this. At the last couple of days, I moved out and lived somewhere else with an uncle or something. I couldn't stay there anymore. I couldn't stay in the house. It was too hard. I could not stay in the house anymore. It's too difficult. Two families in one house, it's really difficult and really tough. And they did it. Yet they did it. Some of them for decades. They, some of the Muhajirin, by the way, never actually made it financially. And they stayed in the houses of the Ansar. And the Ansar had them there. And they intermarried and they just continued to live, and the people came in, died off, and just it went on. Very hard. Wallah, very difficult to understand. Anyways, but that's an example for you of how the concept of shukr can become a societal way of looking at things. We are thankful as a group mentality. We are grateful. And we, every good thing that we have, we're going to give back. And make sure that we look for someone who doesn't have it and make sure that they have it. A group that needs it and make sure that we offer it to them. An act of our shukr is da'wah. An example of shukr is da'wah. Right? We have something beautiful, we would like to offer it to others. But if that beautiful thing is not helping us, I'm not sure how we expect it to help others. Meaning, if the beautiful thing that we have, this awesome thing called Islam, is not actually helping us, it's not taking us anywhere, we're not moving forward with it, I don't understand how we expect to offer it to someone else who doesn't understand any of it, and expect it to actually help them. That doesn't make any sense. It has to help you first, right? You're supposed to take it, and it's supposed to let you thrive, and then offer it. Shukr is a very specific action. You can only do it if you have something. If you have nothing, then you're in sabr, you're not in shukr. No one's telling someone who is severely, terminally ill to show shukr. No, you tell them show sabr, because they have nothing to be, they don't have something to be thankful for. They have sabr, yet they have to show perseverance and acceptance, and they're not objecting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they're holding on. And that's beautiful, and you're supposed to do that. But how do you show shukr? You have to have something. You have to have something worthy of gratitude. But if you don't have, then I don't understand how you show shukr. So what this is suggesting as well is that your communities are supposed to thrive, so you have something to be thankful for, so you can be thankful for it. But if you don't have anything to be thankful for, meaning you're not achieving the basic minimums, you're not taking care of the weakest part of your society, you're not taking care of the elderly or the ill or the children or the disabled, these people aren't being cared for, then I don't know what you hope to what are you doing? And before you start sowing shukr, you need to fix the internal musibah that you have. And then when you do that, you can start being thankful. And how you be thankful is you give, you don't waste, and you don't harm. I'm just giving three examples that are simple, that are Quranic. And this is what the Quran talks about. But you can find many others. You can find many other ways to manifest even gratitude from a societal perspective. Okay. The final few words of the ayah. So, كُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِ رَبِّكُمْ وَاشْكُرُوا لَهُ بَلْدَةٌ طَيِّبَةٌ وَرَبٌ غَفُورٌ. Beautiful way of ending the ayah. It's بَلْدَةٌ طَيِّبَةٌ, a nice country. طَيِّبَ طَابَ شَيْءٌ إِذَا حَسُنٌ. طَيِّب means something that is just, generally speaking, all around just good. That's why فَلَنُحْيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً. He'll live a good life. Doesn't mean he'll be rich, doesn't mean he'll live long, doesn't mean he'll always be healthy. Just be a good life. All in all, when looked at from afar, everything about it, just the net worth of this life was good. So بَلْدٌ طَيِّبَةً, meaning this country, this society was طَيِّبَةً. The net worth, the bottom line, it was everything was good. Everything was positive. It wasn't a country in debt, it was not in war, it was not in poverty, it was not in oppression, it was functioning well. وَرَبٌّ غَفُورٌ, and it had a forgiving Lord. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so the country has everything working for it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving. Everything sounds nice. It's like the end, you're listening to the beginning of a fairy tale or a story. Right? So it was a nice country, and it had a forgiving Lord, and everything was just working out, fine. Everything was fine. So we all hope for, right? Everything just turns out fine and just works out, and alhamdulillah, you have the money, you're healthy, you're happy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave your sins, we're good to go. بَلْدَةٌ طَيِّبَةٌ, happy, successful, thriving, بَلْدَ طَيِّبَةٌ, بَلْدَ means a society or a community or country. وَرَبٌّ غَفُورٌ, and a forgiving Lord. We recite the ayah after it. فَأَعْرَضُوا فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمِ. وبدلناهم بجنتيهم جنتين ذواتي أكل
وبدلناهم بجنتيهم جنتين ذواتي أكل
ذواتي أكل خمط وأثل وشيء من سدر قليل. Alright, so these words are a bit hard to read. So ذواتي أكل خمط وأثل وشيء من سدر قليل. فأعرضوا. So that's the point in the story. This is where the things change. فأعرضوا means they turned their backs. They turned their backs to that specific command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were given two orchards on both sides, meaning they were surrounded by provision. And they had a very successful country. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very forgiving to all the mistakes. And they were told, eat, meaning enjoy it, not don't starve yourselves, enjoy it, and just show gratitude and thanks for it. فَأَعْرَضُوا They turned their backs to that. They were taught what to do, and they refused it. They refused to show the form of submission that they were supposed to show. The same form that Dawood and Sulaiman alayhi salam were told to show, and they did. So the difference between them. فَأَعْرَضُوا So what happened? فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمْ And upon them was sent Sayl is a flood. Al-Arim is the name of the flood. This is a very known flood within Arabic history, meaning it's one of the hallmarks or the one of the changing points within Arabic history when a flood happened to Maghrib in Yemen, and the society and the civilization of Saba, Sheba fell to pieces, and people had to leave and go in different directions. This is a very known part of Arabic history. So Al-Arim also means something that is very forceful. The word arim or ta'arrama shay, meaning it becomes very strong, very forceful, it's very aggressive. So فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمْ could be the name of it, or could be the description of it. So it was a very forceful and aggressive flood that was sent upon them. وَبَدَّلْنَاهُمْ And they were substituted. بِجَنَّتَيْهِمْ With the two orchards that were surrounding them. جَنَّتَيْهِمْ With two other orchards. ذَوَاتَيْ أُكُلٍ خَمْطٍ That had within it bitter tasting fruit, meaning the trees that were once full of sweet fruit were now carrying bitter fruit. Khamt is bitter. Akukulin khamt, so something that tasted bitter. Wa athil, and athil, the meaning of it is when I looked this up a number of times, and I still don't know what it means in English. I'm not sure. It's called tamarisk in English. That's basically what the name of the tree is. In Arab, I know what it is in Arabic because I actually have trees of that in our where I live. But athil is something similar to saru. So it's something similar to a pine tree. It's similar to a pine tree. It's not necessarily a pine tree, but tamarisk is similar to a type of pine tree. If you know pine trees, they don't really carry anything that's worthy of food, and they take a lot of space, and their roots go down quite deep. They don't do much in terms of prosper for a country. وَشَيْءٍ مِّن سِدْرٍ قَلِيلٍ And a small amount of lote trees. Sidr is are trees that have huge, lote trees usually have big leaves, and they don't really carry anything that is edible. And they're called lote trees. وَشَيْءٍ مِّن سِدْرٍ قَلِيلٍ So they went from the agriculture landscape of what they had was once very fruitful, meaning the trees carried all the sweet fruits I could imagine, and then this flood happened, and this ruined basically how the distribution of water went through the country, which caused these trees that needed periodic water to all die off, and instead of it come trees that didn't need as much, that had bitter taste, that were tamarisks and lote trees, and they didn't have the prosperity that they once had before. وَشَيْءٍ مِّن سِدْرٍ قَلِيلٍ So they lost the provision of the agriculture prosperity that they once had. And it went away. Now before I continue, I have to make a point that is really important. It's very, very crucial for you that if you see on TV or you hear of a natural phenomenon or natural disaster, that you do not politicize that natural disaster. You do not have the right or the ability to point at a natural disaster and say that was punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do not have the ability to do that, and that is very dangerous. Never do it, because you are now putting yourself in a position where you are making decisions on behalf of God, and you're saying Allah did this because of that, and you do not know that, and you'll be held accountable for it, even if you're correct. Even if you're correct, because you said something that you had no evidence to support, and you are going ahead and taking the position of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and dictating why something happened. We don't know why things happen. We don't know. What happens, whether it's a blessing or it's a punishment, is based on how you respond to it. What happens to you in your life, whether it's a blessing or it's a punishment, is based almost exclusively on how you deal with it. If you're given a difficulty and you show sabr, this becomes a blessing yawm al-qiyamah, and this is an act of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanting to raise you higher in Jannah. And if you're given money and then you waste it, this is a punishment because it's going to take you lower in Jahannam yawm al-qiyamah. So nothing you get is a ni'mah or a niqmah unless you've already reacted to it, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pointed it out. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He can point out whatever He wants. He can look at something and say, that was punishment. That is His right, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, He talked about the flood, and He said it was a punishment. Does that mean every flood is a punishment? No. Never say that. You're not allowed to say that. You're not allowed to ever even assume that. And if you say that, I fear for you. So if your enemy one day has his earth is flood or an earthquake, do not dare stand there with any level of shamata, as they say in Arabic, where you're kind of enjoying it, feeling, yeah, see, I knew it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished them. You don't know that. Because when it happens to your people, then what is it? Is it also punishment? We don't know these things. We just deal with it how it comes. And we fear from punishment. And when we're given something good, we're thankful. When we're given something difficult, we persevere. And that's it. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala points something out as azab, we accept it because He's pointing it out, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has the right to do that. But I don't, and you don't, and no one does. And I see this too often, and it really bothers me. Where you see someone who is a criminal, a criminal, and then gets very ill. And they say, see, punishment. No, what are you doing? What are we going to call, what happens if you get ill or your family member gets ill? Is that punishment as well? How do you, don't say these things. You don't know. Just say, Allahumma ahsin khitaman, and that's it. Just ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you a good ending and to grant you sabr and shukr for everything that comes your way and make it easy. But don't say these things. And I see it too often. And I've been seeing it since I was very young. And I remember this used to be a part of the way I used to think. And it only changed when I actually learned the deen properly. Don't look at natural disasters. If you remember, there was a tsunami sometime in 2006 or 7 or something like that. And we were flooded by Islamic speakers saying that, you see, that beach was a nude beach and that's why Allah... What are you doing? How do you know this? Did He speak to you personally, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and tell you that this was punishment? You don't know that. Don't know that. Learn from this. When you see something like that, learn. Take a lesson. But do not state that this is punishment, or you don't know that. That is very, very dangerous. It's very dangerous because now you're putting yourself in a position where you act like you have knowledge that you do not have. You do not have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not specify, so we don't know. So even when people of sin are going through disaster, we don't call it punishment. And just like when we see people of piety going through difficulty, we don't call it punishment, we don't call it a blessing either. Everything is based on how people respond to things. Everything is based on how people respond to things, especially when they're natural phenomenons, when they're things that people don't control, like an earthquake or a tornado or a flood or anything like that. And I think it's very important that is clear to everyone. Because it's not acceptable. From an Islamic perspective, it's not acceptable. هذا تألن على الله سبحانه وتعالى. You are putting yourself in a position that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not grant you. You don't have the right to say that. Okay. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very, very clear. They said no, they refused to do shukr. So we sent this upon them. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, this is what I did for them. I punished them for it. Now that punishment itself could have become a blessing had they responded properly to it, but they didn't. They refused to do it. So we say the ayah after it. ذَلِكَ جَزَيْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَفَرُوا وَهَلْ نُجَازِي إِلَّا الْكَفُورُ. So he stated it clearly here. ذَلِكَ, that is what we did for them. جَزَيْنَاهُمْ, we have rewarded, we have punished them, or we have treated them accordingly. بِمَا كَفَرُوا, to the fact that they were not thankful. Kufr here is not disbelief. Kufr here is the opposite of shukr. So kufr actually means the refusal of gratitude. It's when you refuse to be grateful. That's what kufr actually means. It's juhudun ni'mah. It's saying that this is not a blessing. I don't accept this as a blessing. It's not a blessing. That's what kufr actually means. Well, how did kufr become the opposite of faith? Because kufr on its highest levels, so is when you deny the blessing of life. You're alive, you deny that it's a blessing That is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you're alive, you deny that He gave that to you, and that is kufr. You refuse that He created you. And that's the highest level of kufr. And that's when it's against, that's when it's the opposite of faith. But generally speaking, kufr just means for you to deny a blessing and not want to show gratitude for it. So ذَلِكَ جَزَيْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَفَرُوا. With what we did to them, we have punished them for their lack of gratitude, for their refusal to show gratitude. وَهَلْ نُجَازِي إِلَى الْكَفُورِ. And we only, listen to this, and we only punish those who refuse to show gratitude. We only punish those who refuse to show gratitude. So if someone who is being very grateful, but then he is given a musibah in his life, is that a punishment? No, by definition of the ayah, it's not. Because he is not kafur, he is not someone who refused to show gratitude. He shows gratitude all the time, and this is not punishment to him. What's the backlash of this understanding? Which is, in my assessment, more dangerous than anything. If you choose to understand every bad thing that happens to a bad person as punishment, then how do you explain bad things happening to you when you're not a bad person? How do you explain it? I've seen it so many times that I have no doubt in my mind. I've seen it so many times where people live good lives and they're good people, they do good things and they're pious and they're grateful and they're very generous, but they have this a problematic understanding where they believe that because of that they will not be tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believe because of that, they're not going to be tested, not going to be given a difficulty. Some of them are lucky and they go through life, it doesn't happen, and some of them aren't. Now, the ones who aren't lucky are the ones who are given a musibah, even though they're very good people, and then they don't know how to explain it. How did this happen? I've always been good, I've always been generous, I've never been, I've always been grateful, I've always shown shukr. Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take all my money away? Why am I sick? Why did I lose a loved one? Why? Well, see, you misunderstood the whole deal. Nothing that happens to people can be explained as iqab, thawab, all about how you respond to it. So you live a good life, and you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy, but living a good life and being a good person and being kareem and being shakur does not mean that you won't be tested. Does not mean that you may lose what you already have. Doesn't mean that. You may lose what you have, but it's not going to be an act of punishment. That's what you know deep inside. Because He said subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَهَلْ نُجَازِي إِلَى الْكَفُورِ. We don't punish anyone except those who refuse to show gratitude. So if you knew that you were someone who was grateful, then what happened to you was not punishment. Understand how it's not punishment, is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you accept and you move forward with. I've seen so too many people lose their faith over problems like this. I've seen it happen too many times, and it scares me for myself and for others. Live a life of piety, live a life of following the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but don't do it conditionally. Don't do it conditionally. Don't put any conditions to this, that I'm going to live it like that, but I'm not going to be tested, I'm not going to be given a difficulty. I'm not, no. Don't say that. And when you see other people going through difficulties, don't say that's because of a mistake that they made or something wrong that they did or they deserved it. Just don't say that, because you don't know when things happen to others why they happened and what the reasoning behind it is. You don't know, so never say it. Yes. Waiting for that. Okay, wait for that. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Around 260 something of them. Is arih nafsaka min al-hammi ba'da at-tadbir. Fama qama bihi ghayruka lak la taqum bihi li nafsik. What it means in English is, relieve yourself from worry after you have put in the due diligence of an activity, for a certain activity or for a certain goal. After you've tried everything, after you exhausted your resources, after you did tadbir, after you tried your best to plan it all out properly, relieve yourself from worry. Because another one has done for you, you should not go ahead and do it for yourself again. It's a waste of time. Now what he means here is, it's a proverb. What he means here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He did something for you. He took care of how things are going to turn out. So why are you worrying about it? He did it for you. Why are you doing it again? I mean, that part, the part of how it's going to turn out, he took care of. Don't worry about it. You do your part and I'll take care of how it'll turn out. So if you sit around worrying about that part, why are you doing for yourself something that was already done? That's a complete waste of time. You're wasting your time. And that is what worry is. Now, in English, worry is a waste of time. In Arabic, hum has more than one meaning, so sometimes it's not. But for the majority of time, of situations and contexts, worry is a complete waste of time. What do they worry for? Meaning you've studied, you've done your best, and you wrote your exam, and you left. Now you're going to wait a week until you get the exam, the result back. So if you worry within that whole time, my question is, what does that do for you? How does that change the outcome? Nothing. It does nothing. It's a complete waste of time. It actually exhausts and drains you, exhausts your resources, and it drains you out. You get very tired, you become less productive, you develop anxiety, and you're just not happy anymore. And the reason is that you're doing something that you were specifically told not to do. You were told not to do it to begin with. This is not a part of what you're supposed to think about. You're supposed to focus on exhausting resources of planning and executing what you want to do. And then how it turns out is no longer in your hands. And if you can learn to live like that, you will be happy. The word that you'll be a happy person, which is what we all want to be at the end. You will be happy. If you can do that, you're going to be a happy person. And if you can't do it, then you will never be happy. Nothing will make you happy. Nothing can make you happy. Because you're caught up on parts of your life that you do not control, that you were told not to try and control, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself took and put it in his own hands. And it's very rude for you to try and take it away from his hand and put it in your own. What's worse than all that is for you not to do tadbir. Now this is the point that I find problematic today. Is that when you don't do tadbir, meaning you don't plan things out, you don't try your best, you don't put in the effort. You don't do that. Of course you're going to worry. Of course you're going to worry because you didn't do anything. Because you didn't study for your exam. Of course you're going to be worrying all night long because you wasted 6 months of no effort whatsoever. And now you're faced with the consequences of what you did. But still with that, you shouldn't worry. Still with that, you shouldn't live a life of worry. You should accept the fact that you didn't do your part. And that this is not going to work out. And that you need to revise and try again. And you need to take a step back and say, I don't know why I wasted time with this. That was a mistake. It's dumb. There's no reason for it. There's no excuse for it. And then you reevaluate, reassess, and try again. Worry, no matter how you look at it, the act of worry is a complete waste of time. There's a beautiful surah in the Quran that maybe we'll come to. Actually, we've already done in this halaqah a few years ago. In Surah Al-Sharh, the opening of the chest or the ease of mind. That's what Sharh means, to have an ease of mind. The Prophet ﷺ was told in it, Inna ma'al usri yusra. With difficulty, you'll find ease. Not after difficulty, you'll find ease. Not before difficulty. With difficulty. With the difficulty itself, there'll be enough ease for you to get through it. With each difficulty you're given, there'll be enough ease in it for you to get through it. So don't worry about it. Don't worry about what may come. Don't worry about what difficulty may be thrown your way, because that's a waste of time. If you're worried, and I see this a lot, especially in younger, in teenage ages, they worry about getting injured, they worry about getting sick, they worry about their parents breaking up, they worry about not having money. Don't worry about things. There'll be enough ease in whatever difficulty you're given for you to get through it. So don't worry about it. فَإِنَّمَا نُسْرِ يُسْرَ. That was specific to the Prophet's life, because he was worrying about whether he was going to memorize the Quran properly. Would he forget any of it? Will he practice it properly? Will he be able to do da'wah properly? He felt this, it was an overwhelming mission he was given, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he worried that he wasn't going to get it done. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't worry. Inna ma'al usri yusra. With difficulty, there'll be enough ease for you to get through it. Was there, with each difficulty he was given, enough ease to get through it? Yes. He lost his son. He lost his other son. He lost his wife, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He lost three daughters. He lost two uncles and an aunt, and he lost an adopted son, and he lost three cousins, and he lost, and there was enough ease in all of it for him to get through it, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to wake up with a smile and not to be in constant worry and in constant anxiety. Does that make sense? So this hikmah, what it's saying is, arih nafsak, relieve yourself min alham, from worry, ba'd al-tadbir, after you do your job, after you've done your part. Did you do everything you could? Yes, I did everything I could. All right, don't worry anymore. But I can't. Yes, you can. I can't worry. You cannot worry. You can learn not to worry. It takes time. It's not something that will happen. It's not a snap of your finger. It'll take time, but you can learn to no longer worry after you've done your best. And just accept whatever you get from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I tried my best. We'll see. I applied. I may get accepted. I may not. I'm not worrying about it. Why? Because I tried my best. I have nothing to regret. The part of this working out is in someone else's hand. He's already done his part. Why would I try to do it for him? فَمَا قَامَ بِهِ غَيْرُكَ لَكْ لَا تَقُمْ بِهِ لِنَفْسِكَ. It's a waste of your time. It's a waste of your effort to do something that someone else has already done for you. It's already done. Go enjoy your time. Go enjoy your life. Or come up with a plan B. Or come up with a plan C. As he did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his life many, many times. Did the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, get what he wanted every time he did something? No. Many, many times he asked for things, he wanted things, he strived to achieve things, and it didn't work out. You never saw him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a state of continuous and constant worry. That doesn't mean that you're someone who will never feel difficulty, who won't experience hardship, it doesn't mean that we'll look at your face and you're always going to be in complete carefree. No, you're not going to be carefree. I'm talking about worry that is pathological, toxic worry. I'm talking about the amount of worry that is literally useless, that clogs up your arteries and turns off parts of your brain and gives you diabetes and hypertension. That's the type of worry that I'm talking about, the one that destroys your body, that makes you miserable. But of course, there's a certain level of anxiety and of worry that is healthy. It keeps the brain functioning at 100% for you to care about what's happening next. You care about the outcome, you care about getting this done. I'm not saying you do something, you don't care how it works out, whatever. No. If you actually care, if you're doing your best, then you will. It'll be obvious upon you that you actually care about what's going to happen next. But what I'm talking about is the amount of worry that is toxic, the amount of worry that is harmful, that there's no benefit from at all, that will not do you any good, that will only make life difficult for you. Don't have that type of worry. And always remind yourself of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna ma'al usri yusra." With difficulty, indeed with difficulty, there will be ease. You will find, doesn't mean after difficulty there'll be ease. Some people get sick and die, and there'll be no ease after their difficulty. Sometimes things will be destroyed and they'll never be fixed again, so there's no difficult ease after it. But within that difficulty, you'll find enough ease. That's why the end of the surah says, فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ فَانْصَبْ. When you're done doing your job, when you've done your part, when you did tadbir, فَانْصَبْ. فَانْصَبْ means find another thing to do. Fansab doesn't mean to stand up, by the way. That has nothing to do with prayer. Fansab means go ahead and find a second step. Find something else you can start working on. Fansab wa ila rabbika farghab, and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, show your greed in His mercy and in His bounty subhanahu wa ta'ala, and keep on working. And don't waste time worrying about things in a way that will not help you achieve anything in the future. I'll end with that, inshaAllah ta'ala. We will continue, inshaAllah, the halaqah next week as well. Subhanakallah bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant.